Well, good morning, Gabby, and good morning, everybody else. Welcome to Catalina Foothills Church. My name's John Stone, and I'm the pastor here, and it's an honor to have you come and worship with us on behalf of the session and the deacons and the staff. We want to thank you and welcome you all together for being here. We look forward to worshiping with you. Especially want to thank and honor our dad today. It is Father's Day. So if that's the first you remember of that, immediately run outside afterwards and call your dad and catch up or send him a text or something. If not, good for you, but it is Father's Day and happy Father's Day. We're glad to have you. As you know, every week we gather here to rest in the Lord Jesus Christ. We want to come into the promises of Christ, and we want to give ourselves over to Jesus so that we can rest in who Jesus is and what he's done for us. We also want to spend time this week reminding each other that Jesus loves us, and he calls us to love him back, because it's easy to forget that he loves us. It's easy to forget that he calls us to love him back. But we hope that if we rest in Christ and that we remind each other of the love of Christ, we'll reflect the love of God, not simply in our church, but here in Tucson and in our neighborhoods and throughout the Southwest, wherever we go, telling others about the great love and the beauty of the gospel. So we're glad you're here this morning. Welcome to worship, where we hope to rest in, remind each other of, and reflect the gospel. With that being said, would you stand with me for the call to worship? It comes from Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors by the prophets. God made the world through his Son, who has been appointed heir of all things and the perfect reflection of God's glory. Praise God for the gift of his Son. Would you pray with me? We thank you, Father, that because of who Jesus is, your Son, and what he's done for us, dying in our place, we can come now and worship in freedom. We can come now and worship as those who've been forgiven, who are free of shame and guilt, and who have your righteousness. We thank you for a beautiful day. We thank you for a place to worship. We thank you for beautiful musicians to worship with. So as we come, pour out the Holy Spirit on us, that we would be made more like you, Jesus. Whether we come full of faith or full of doubt, whether we come needing healing or having been healed, whether we come in a place of just confusion, would you meet us here and make us your people and teach us and lead us? Lord, we need you, and so we come to you giving ourselves to you in worship. And we pray this, Jesus, for your name's sake. Amen. Let's sing together. Thank you.
so much for worshiping with us this morning. And again, a happy Father's Day, and especially happy Father's Day to my father, who's faithfully in this congregation every single week. Thank you, Dad. So like we say in our confession of faith, love always protects, it always trusts, it always hopes, and it always perseveres. Love never fails. So now we're going to sing a song about it. All right, let's see if we can get this clapping. You can do it. There you go. Now let's be seated for a confession of sin.
We come to the part where we confess our sin together, and we're using this confession in front of us. It's easy to think of God this way, that, hey, if I confess my sin, He'll love me. Or if I don't actually sin, He'll love me. Which can make us afraid to confess our sin, but the gospel actually says the opposite. And we're going to see this in the sermon. The beauty of the gospel is this: you can be known and loved. You can be known and loved. And that's why we confess our sins, because we can. Because God wants to hear even this from us. So that's why we do this as a regular part of worship. So Christians, I'm going to ask you, What is your confession of sin? Heavenly Father, we confess that we do not give ourselves to you completely as you deserve. We're fearful about our relationships, our health, our finances, our families, our culture, our futures, and general storms of life. We often fail to think about and pray for our neighbors while constantly worrying about our own lives. We often doubt your love and concern for us, at times your very existence. We are not calmed by your presence with us. In our darkest moments, we are obsessed with ourselves instead of Jesus. Father, forgive our unbelief and restore to us the joy, peace, and rest that are found only in Jesus, our older brother. Hear now, Lord, our silent confession of sin. Amen. We offer these to you, Jesus, in your own name. Amen. Christians, lift up your heads and hear these words from God's word about the compassion and the forgiveness we have in our brother Jesus. Who is a God like you pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in steadfast love. He delights in steadfast love. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. God will cast all our sins from the depths of the sea. Christians, you are forgiven because of the work of Christ. The Lord loves to forgive his people. Therefore, let us rise and sing his praise.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Mom.
God.
John 4:23 to 24. Yet a time is coming, and has now come, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the Spirit and in truth.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you.
So here I
to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Thank you.
altogether wonderful, altogether worthy. And we confess our faith to our God. It is worthy, who He is worthy and wonderful. And we confess this to Him, to ourselves, to each other, and to a world that really needs it. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. 1 Corinthians teaches us that these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. So, Christian, what do you believe about love? If I give all I possess to the poor, and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails.
You may be seated.
Good morning, church. My name is Peter Pomonas. I'm an elder here, and I'm here to pray with you this morning. So would you please bow your heads? Heavenly Father, we come to you today in the name of Jesus, your Son and our Savior. We have so much to be thankful for. You are the God of all, and you are great beyond our comprehension. You are to be praised, so we gather here today to glorify and worship you, not only for what you do, but for who you are and for what you are. Your word tells us that you are God of all mankind, and there's nothing too hard for you. You're able to do exceedingly more than we can ask or think or desire or hope for. How great it is to be a Christian. We are part of your eternal plan, a plan that goes back before the world was even made when you knew us. And just as we place our faith in you alone for salvation, we need to trust you today for all of life's problems and difficulties. You're always here and you're always ready to help us when we call on you. You're always with us, even when we're not aware of your presence. We give you our thanks and we acknowledge you today. And now, Lord, we invite you to look into our hearts. Your grace shines into the darkest nooks and crannies of our lives and reveals to us who we really are. But your grace also assures us that regardless of our circumstances, we can be victorious through Jesus Christ. So please help each one of us in exactly the way we need you. There are those here this morning that have problems and difficulties and burdens that they are carrying. They came here today hoping to hear some word or to experience a special moving of your Spirit that will give them encouragement. Let them know that they are not forsaken or forgotten. Be to them exactly what they need here and now as they reach out to you for your grace. We're thinking especially today about those with sicknesses and physical problems, particularly Clint, Dave, Michelle, Jacob, Bob, and the Garcia family. And Father, we lift up Bellamy, who is waiting for a kidney donor. We pray for our country, for our president and vice president and the members of his cabinet. We pray, too, for the members of Congress. We ask you help them to make good and godly decisions and not lead into sin. We pray for the women and men in the courts in the land that they will be influenced by the Holy Spirit in the decisions and rulings they make. We pray for the missionary forces around the world as they labor to bring your word to many needy countries. We pray for those who are in closed countries where people cannot witness openly, that those people's hearts and minds will be opened. We pray for Pastor Stone as he brings the message that you have given to him for us to hear. May the words from his mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you. We pray all these in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen.
I also want to update you on our VBS we had. We want to show you some pictures. We had a great week at VBS 2 weeks ago. I really want to thank the interns who are working with our youth. and all the volunteers. We had a ton of volunteers and interns, and we had about 140 kids here that week. We had a few families who don't regularly attend church, don't go to any church, who had their kids here. So it was just a wonderful week. Thank you, and it was just awesome. We look forward to doing it again. We had on Saturday Dress a Girl, and the notes say, hold up the dress. So we make these dresses. About 15 ladies gathered yesterday under the leadership of Sandy Woods. Thank you, Sandy Woods. And made these dresses that will be on their way to Ecuador. And these aren't just cute dresses, although they are cute. They help girls feel valued and loved. And they help protect vulnerable girls from trafficking and abuse because they send a message that a child is well cared for. And there are more dresses, examples out there that you can look at. But we want to thank all of you who did this. And go there for me. Thank you. And we really appreciate everybody who sewed. As I said last week, we need ushers. And you can sign up to be online in the Friday footprint or scan the QR code at the welcome desk to sign up to be an usher. We'll train you. What does it take to be an usher? That's it. Can you hold these? Can you smile and hand them to people? That's it. You don't have to protect a hot flock. You don't need to take a bullet if somebody comes with a gun. You just need to hold these. And anybody of any sex and any age can do this. So please sign up. We need ushers. We also need a bike. I know when I moved, I had a lot of things I got rid of. But one of our young professionals had her bike stolen, and it was her main source of transportation. So if you have, and the key to this sentence is a good bike, not the one you've been intending to fix, but a good bike that you can loan or donate, please contact Nick Clausen at the number on your screen, or there's also information in the Friday footprint. We'd appreciate it. We also need bass players for this service. So if you're someone who plays the bass, would you contact Alicia Peru? Her email is up there, but we need them. And also, we're still raising money for our Catalina Bells, so please think about donating to that. We're more than halfway home. We look forward to being able to buy new bells. And finally, starting July the 4th, and the first Sunday of every month going forward, we're going to have a healing service between the services. So from 10:10 to 10:40, for that 30 minutes, we'll designate a place where Winston and others, our elders, and will be, and we will anoint with oil and pray for those who would like healing. You're invited to go if you just like to go pray for those. So you don't need to be seeking healing. Thank you, Essie. Appreciate it. But you can just go and receive. But we need you to go even if you don't need it. So we have several people to pray. We'll keep announcing that. But the first one is coming up on July 4th. We know where Essie stands on this issue. So we've come to our passage today, which is 1 Corinthians 13. And 1 Corinthians 13 is very famous. Some of you probably had this passage read at your wedding. I will tell you, after studying it all week, I don't think that's why Paul wrote it. He did not have your wedding in mind. He was thinking more about Christians and their enemies and Christians and their kind of distance relations, not Christians and their close relationships. It's probably some of Paul's best writing. It's his most eloquent writing. But what I want you to notice is also some of Paul's most exclusive words. So the one thing that Christendom has agreed on from the very beginning, maybe really the only thing we've agreed on, is that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and in him there is salvation. And that kind of exclusive language that Christians have used from the beginning is reserved for very few things. The way we think about baptism is not reserved for that kind of exclusive language. The way we think about election, you don't have that kind of exclusive language. But Paul uses incredibly exclusive language about his thinking about love. And he really sort of puts it in a place that we're not used to him. So let's read it together and then enter into what Paul thinks about love. Verse 1, 1 Corinthians 13, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they'll cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. Amen. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of God stands forever. Let's pray and ask God to teach us his word. Lord, teach us about love, about your love. Be our leader and our guide through this. And we pray this for your name's sake. Amen. And the job that I had before, I worked for an organization, and many of you know, called RUF, which is a campus ministry. I worked over the campus ministry. I had been a particular campus ministry, but in this part of my job, it was my job to recruit and then train and encourage campus ministers. So that meant that I often visited campuses and evaluated campus ministers and sort of figured out where they were. One of the things that became apparent to me, and this wasn't true of a lot of our campus ministers, but it was true of some of our campus ministers, is that they had a lot of reasons, a lot of motives for being in RUF, but they may not have had the right motive. RUF was a really fantastic organization. It was a great organization to work for. There was a lot of esprit de corps. There was great training. It was great preparation for ministry. But as I went around, I noticed that some of my campus ministers lacked a key perspective on what it meant to be a good campus minister, and it was this: they didn't like college students. And I'm very serious about this. They loved RUF. They loved the training. They loved their coworkers. They loved the idea of the ministry. They just failed to like college students. Now, let's not criticize them. College students aren't the easiest group of people to love. They go to bed about 3:30 or 4 a.m. They sleep till 11 a.m. They have their own language. They have their own way of communicating. They have their own way. I mean, when you go to the University of Arizona, you realize you're almost traveling when you go from downtown Tucson to the University of Arizona. You're almost culturally going as far as it is like if you travel to Africa. They're not easy to love. I can remember going to my own large Bible study one night. This is way back in the 80s, and I saw the entire group of my students walking down the sidewalk. I was proud they were going, and they walked right by the hall we were meeting in and went to the Nickel Creek concert. I had like 15. That's college students, right? They're beautiful. They're wonderful, but if you're going to do college ministry, you need to love college students. Paul's saying something very similar to this here. He's saying if you're going to be a Christian, if you want to know what it is to be a Christian, then you have to recognize that the main characteristic that should flow out of a Christian is love. And he uses very strong language in this passage to make this point that love is a key ingredient that comes out of Christians. And so I want us to think about this call to love, his call for us to love today, and I want to think about it in three ways. I want to think about the necessity of love, I want to think about the work of love, and then I want to think about the triumph of love. I want to think about the necessity, the work, and the triumph. First of all, the necessity, and these are those really powerful words Paul uses at the beginning of the passage. And look, the passage is intended, as it were, to wound us. It really is. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. These images are images from pagan temples. He's saying, if I can speak in the tongues of men and in the tongues of angels, but I don't love, I'm like a pagan ritual in worship. If I have the gift of prophecy, I can predict the future. And I can fathom all the mysteries. I understand I can bring together free will and predestination. I have all knowledge. And if I have faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. And this is sort of for the modern world, for those who rightly and understandably care about justice and poverty. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Paul says that the central issue in being a Christian is that we would become loving, that love would be a part of our heart, that love would dig down into our heart, and it would become a part of who we are. It needs to get in us. Love needs to become something that I am. It needs to become a deep part of my heart. If love is not at the center, this is what he's saying, right? Not what John Stone is saying. If love is not at the center of what we do, then we're not doing it as a Christian. And I just repeat, and I would encourage you to read this once a month. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. I mean, these are crazy powerful words. If I give everything I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. What Paul is teaching is that love growing from our hearts is an absolute necessity of what it means to be a Christian. It is an absolute necessity. When I was traveling in my job for RUF, I often had to fly places. And in this particular trip, I had flown to the West Coast. I had landed at LAX. No, this is actually, I had landed at SFO. I had gone to University of Berkeley. I had gone to Stanford and had gone to San Jose. We had ministries at those campuses, and I had visited with them. This was a Thursday morning, and I had gone back to the airport that morning to fly home. I was packed. I was prepared. And what was interesting about that particular morning is I was early. I just woke up super early, got in my rental car, returned it to Hertz, was standing there at the kiosk. I had a Delta number. I was a frequent flyer. I had the points. I had the status. And I put in 239, blah, 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 boom. No flight. Well, I know I have a flight. I bought the ticket. I flew out here. Okay, let me try it. I've never done this. Let me put my name in. No flight. I never had done this. Found my email confirmation. No flight today. No problem. I'll just walk down to the desk. I walked down to the desk. I said, ma'am, name's John Stone. Here's my number, 239, blah, 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 blah. She goes, yeah, let me. She goes, you got a problem. I said, you're right. She goes, you absolutely have a return ticket for a year from today. I said, I didn't mean to live here for a year. She goes, I bet you didn't. Suitcase is packed, way ahead of time. Driver's license in hand, Delta number, status, no ticket. Tell you what's absolutely necessary to get from San Francisco to Knoxville, Tennessee by airfare. A ticket. Doesn't matter what else you have if you don't have a ticket. This is what Paul is saying. Let's say it in a really helpful way. If I read the Bible every day, if I pray every day, if I know my theology well, and I have not love, I have nothing. These are scary words. Look, if I get up every day and work for justice, but have not love, I have nothing. If I go to Wheaton College or Grand Canyon, I'm not going to pick on Bush Ridge this time, or Desert Christian, every day to give my life for kids in the name of Christ, but I lack love, I have nothing. If I can deconstruct critical race theory and socialism and republicanism and democratism, and I don't have love, I have nothing. If I vote for the right candidate without love, I have nothing. Paul is absolutely clear that what should be happening in your heart and in my heart is that I should be growing in love. And he uses the word agape throughout this passage, God's love. That what is necessary in the heart of a Christian is love. And I want you to just own that it's easy to put other things in there rather than love. It's easy to know my Bible or to know my theology or to know what I want to see done in the world and to do it without love. That's actually easy. It is love that is necessary. But he also says that love is something we have to work at. I think we would like love to be a natural thing. It just flows out of us. And certainly when we think about our children or we think about our families or our friends, that's true. But he also says here that love is something we have to work at. And he uses this language, love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. So hear me clearly. If we take these characteristics and we list out the number there, probably today you get half of them, no problem. You're genetically, characteristically, you're good at these. But I promise you there's something that's going to catch you up. And it's probably, for most of us, keeps no record of wrongs, right? The dude ran over my roses 31 times when I lived in Knoxville. I know. 31 times. 31. Not 32. Not 30. 31. I didn't mean to know that. I didn't set out to know it. Didn't mark it on a calendar. Didn't keep a note. My heart knows it. My heart did not love him running over my roses 31 times. It is not self-seeking love. See, it's patient, it's kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. Somewhere in here, you will recognize that you don't do love well. You. And I will just say those who think they do probably do it the worst. Because love can be seen in what we do, not in what we feel. I really want to challenge sort of the modern assumption that love is a feeling. Yeah, I mean this. For my girls and my wife, I have tremendous feelings of love. But you know when they feel loved by me? When I do the actions of love. Love can be seen in my actions, and it primarily is seen in my desire to bless others, to bless not myself, but the other person. Love's work in my heart is a blessing to others. And this is what that means. Love requires self-denial and self-control. The heart of love is actually dying to yourself and killing yourself that the other person may live. I don't know what it would take to forget the 31 times my rose bush died. I'm being serious. But I'll tell you, what it would start with is me killing my expectation and the right I have to have a rose bush. Because I tell you who never promised me a rose bush, Jesus Christ. I promised myself that rose bush. And for me to stop keeping a record of wrongs, for me to put him forward, for me to enter into his shoes that probably said he was tired and exhausted and having to go to a job every morning he hated, maybe if I did that, I would have to die to my desire for rose bushes. See, what's really at the heart, what it takes to be patient and kind, to not envy, to not boast, to not be proud, to not dishonor the other, what it takes is death to self, to always protect, to always trust, to always hope, to always persevere. I must die to myself. The heart of what we know love to be is that Jesus laid his life down for us that we might have life. It was an exchange. He gave up his life that we might have life, right? He died to himself that we might not. Now, I want you to know that both the Corinthian church and the American church hates this, and that includes us. We hate denying ourselves anything. We hate having to die to ourselves. We We love to write books about boundaries, which are good books. They are. We love to do self-care. Never has a culture been more concerned with self-care that was more miserable in its life. Self-care is important. I'm not mocking it. I just want you to see we're kind of obsessed with everything but the other person. And that love requires death to me that they might have life. See, love means I stop thinking about myself. It's not thinking less of myself, but thinking less about myself. If you don't think we're self-obsessed, just get on Instagram, spend an hour, and then turn it off. We are obsessed, and yet real love requires a death to myself. If you're going to raise children, period, you're going to die to yourself. Tell you what children don't want from a dad, 5-hour golf rounds on Saturday. Tell you what I love 6-hour golf rounds on Saturday. Tell you what children love is you sitting in the dust at a baseball game, sniffing dust and things that'll kill you while they're terrible at baseball. Children love you smelling like chlorine and eating food that's terrible for you inside a gymnasium where they swim for 2 minutes over a 9-hour period. And you go and you're awesome when you know they almost drown. That's love. All relationships require this of us. We ask, what can I get? And what Jesus says is, what can you give? Will you give your life away? We recognize in the middle of this Olympic season, do we not, that elite performance requires a deep death to self. If you've been watching the Olympic trials, over and over and over, they talk about what this person did to get to that platform, and it's no small thing. In some cases, they left their parents at like the age of 8, and they went to this strange school where they took the best parts of the day and they performed, and they took the worst parts of the day and did academics, and they're all A-plus students, they're all 4-point students, and they're all better than us at everything, because elite performance requires you die to yourself. When we watch the Olympics, we're watching the fruit of a bunch of men and women who've given their lives to that thing. That, my friends, is love. Love will always require of you your own death. Jesus says it this way to help you think. You will love the one and hate the other because you cannot serve two masters. I will either serve me or Marissa. And when I serve me, this is true, I hate her. And I can see it in my own head. When I begin to think about me, I can see my resentment at her wrath. You know what she's done to earn that? Nothing. See, real love, the work of love, is death. Love requires our death. Agape love requires that we die that we might love the others. Memorize this. Don't do it at your wedding. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. Love is happy for the other. Love does not speak about itself. Love is humble. Love always honors the other person. Love doesn't think about itself. Love remains calm in the presence of injustice. Love does not remember what went wrong. Love rejoices in good and truth. It protects, it trusts, it hopes, it perseveres. When you really read it that way, you recognize that what the passage is trying to get us to do is to pray. That this kind of love requires me to be on my knees or I'll never have the power to do it. It requires the gospel. But that's not Paul's last word on love. What's interesting about this passage is Paul says something that seems, and we like this, like we would crochet this, but it's not possible, is it? Love never fails. Love never fails, he says. This is the triumph of love. But we need to address the elephant in the room on this, because he says a lot, love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they'll be stilled. Where there's knowledge, it'll pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the completeness comes, what is in part will disappear. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away the child, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. So what does he mean, love never fails? Because some of you have loved people really well. I mean, you have. It's a relative or a friend. And that relative or friend has really turned on you. They've not only turned on you, they've rejected you and become actually evil to you. And in that sense, you might ask the question, well, what does it mean love never fails? Because in this moment in my life, in this real tangible moment that involved my feelings and my life and my actions, love failed. Number one, don't always make love in reference to you. What he means by this is God's love cannot fail. And he says this in an incredibly powerful way. I want to read it twice for you. He says, verse 12, for now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. Paul is saying that God's love cannot fail because God's love is our hope in what we call the gospel here, right? And this is what that is, and we mentioned it in the Confession of Faith. What he's saying here is that we are known and loved. Now, you read this at a wedding and everybody's happy and they're getting married and it's just wonderful. But this is what he says. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. I just mean this. I don't want anyone, especially Marissa, to fully know me. Because I'm just honest enough to tell you that. If you fully know me, you fire me from this position. Thoughts I've had in the pulpit get me fired. I'm being like, this is like, I don't want to be fully known. I want to be the pretend together preacher. Hey, smooth words. Pretend to be good looking. Suck in gut. That's who I want to be. Half the reason I work out is because I got to stand up here and people stare at me, right? I don't want to be fully known, and neither do you. Nobody wants to be full. Oh, I want to be fully known. No, you don't. Unless you get this in your soul, you won't understand the passage, because the gospel's good news is this. He fully knows, and he still loves. He fully knows, and he loves without hesitation. Knowing what we were, he fully loves us, and still he died for us. You know, right, that on the cross, your actual sins were put on Jesus, the particular sins. He received, he knew them, and he loved you. This is the hope of love. This is why love never fails, because you can be known and love. See, he always perseveres in love. He always hopes. He always trusts. He always protects. The one thing that we can be sure that every person in the world wants, certainly me, is we want to be loved. And what he's saying here is that we can be known and loved. The power of the gospel and the power of grace is that when he looks into your soul on the judgment day, he will know, and yet he will still love you. This is really, my friends, the only thing that can change people. Like, it's like only in that context can you do confession. Only in that context can you look at a friend and say, you know, I'm sorry, I'm weak at that. I'm just not good at it. In a world that increasingly says you have to be perfect or everything, or we cancel you, we'll just come as Christians and say, we've already been canceled. Jesus did it on the cross. He canceled us. He said, you're terrible, and you don't know the half of it. And so I'll die in your place. The triumph of love is that we can be known and loved. This is a while back. I got to spend time with a friend who's a cardiologist. And I asked him a question. I think it was a great question. I said, tell me what you love about being a cardiologist. And he paused. I said, okay. Tell me what's great about being a cardiologist. And he paused. I said, explain to me what being a cardiologist is. He goes, oh, that's easy. And he says, and it's dreadful being a cardiologist. I was like, I'm all in. He said, John, being a cardiologist, he said, essentially, 98% of the time, you can be a cardiologist, John Stone. And I know that y'all don't want me to be your cardiologist. I said, tell me about this. He goes, John, it's easy. I'm going to get a certain number of cases tomorrow in the office, and I'm going to tell you what they need to hear. They need to eat better, and they need to exercise, John. That's what they need to do. They need to eat better, and they need to exercise. They're going to come in my office. They're going to sit there. I'm going to look at their EKGs, and they're going, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, all these words. I don't know what they mean. And this is what it's going to say. He's going to look at them and go, we can fix this. You can fix it. Eat better and exercise. And they say the same thing to me. Oh, no, no, contraire, doctor. I need a pill or I need a procedure. But the one thing I'm not going to do is eat better and exercise. He says, John, I never meant to spend, I think it was 9 years and almost $500,000 to be trained to say the same thing to the same people every day who hate the message. Eat better, exercise. And they laugh at me. I can hear them driving to McDonald's, stopping at Chick-fil-A, loving Dairy Queen, and frying it all. And it's not hard. You don't need just simply eat better. Exercise. And he says, John, I don't mean like triathlete. I just mean walk a little bit for me. Get off the couch. They won't have it. He goes, this is a dreadful job. I really meant to help people. They don't want my help. I really wanted to serve people. They don't want my service. And that's what it means to be a cardiologist. And that was the moment God freed me from being a doctor. I'll just tell you that right there. Do you need to learn theology? Be a good thing. Do you need to go be a missionary in another country? That'd be a good thing. Do you need to figure out what's going on in our culture and understand it? That'd be a good thing. But guys, here's the answer. Love. It's not the knowing of theology, although theology can help you understand love. It's not the going to another country, although that's a good thing. What he wants us to do, it's not complex, is to love other people the way he loved us. That is the message. To let love win in our hearts so that like Christ, others will love him because we love them. He loved us first that we might love him. Let me pray for us. Lord, we thank you for the idea of love, the reality of it. And so help us to see its necessity and its work of death and its triumph in you that we can be known and loved. Let this passage, read so many times, read so lightly, weigh on us in the right way. And we would remember that these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. And we pray this, Jesus, for your name's sake. Amen. If we needed more evidence that love wins, we see it here because Jesus gave up his life for us. He sacrificed his body. He bled his blood for us on the cross, that we might be his children. The very essence of the gospel is this exchange where he died in our place, where he suffered in our place, was ultimately resurrected that we could be righteous. We come to this table as Christians to, by faith, eat of his flesh and drink of his blood, and so celebrate who Christ is. And if today you're not a Christian and you're not prepared to follow Christ, we would invite you not to eat. It's not to exclude you. It's because this is actually a confession of faith. This is saying, I believe Jesus died for my sins, and I'm trusting in Jesus Christ alone for my salvation. If that's not where you are today, we're super glad you're here. We hope you keep coming, but you shouldn't eat. But if indeed you are a Christian, we would invite you to come and eat this week, Because on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Eat this as often as you do so in remembrance of me." And he also took a cup and said, "This cup represents a new covenant made in my blood for the forgiveness of sins of many. Drink this as often as you do so in remembrance of me, and therefore proclaim my death until I come." Let's take a few seconds and prepare for this meal. Amen. Christians, we break bread in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we proclaim the great mystery of our faith. These are the gifts of God, they're for the people of God. The body of Christ is broken for you, eat with great joy. The blood of Christ was poured out for you, drink with great joy. Let's stand and sing a song together.
All right. So this is going to be the last week that we're going to close with this song for a while. So if anyone has any suggestions of what song we should close with for this next season, please send me an email and I would love to hear it.
Hands up, heads up. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you, on you, your children, and your grandchildren. Go in his peace. Amen.
Amen.